much, Jim. Thank you very much to our coordinators as well as to members of the Scientific Advisory Committee and to the Kavli Institute, who the purpose actually to organize this conference here. And thank you very much, most of all, to all the presenters and participants for their very high quality works. So I hope, you know, it will make everyone happy, including the Kavli Institute. I will be discussing today the fluid instabilities in interfacial mixing, and in contrast to the yesterday talk, actually this is a work where I would like to mention the contributions also of my students as well as colleagues, and I would like to express my special thanks to the senior colleagues, including Dave Arnett in astrophysics, Professor Glim, the late Professor Meshkov, Bruce Remington, and Srinivasan, who are actually the experimentalists with whom this work was discussed for a number of times. So thank you so much, and let us proceed. So, Raleigh Taylor, I will speak quicker, and the words are written here. So, Raleigh Taylor and Richtmeier-Meshkov instabilities, as well as Raleigh Taylor and Richtmeier-Meshkov interfacial mixing, control a broad range of processes in nature and technology. At astrophysical scales, it's a core collapse supernova and supernova remnants. At atomic scales, this would be inertial confinement fusion and light-matter interaction. There is also the problems associated with microfluidics and nanofabrications and geophysical scales. It's a problems in the Earth's ionosphere. And we had a discussion a couple of days ago about the reconstruction of electromagnetic processes from Arizona State, as well as gas oil production and fluid atomization, which we have been just discussed. These instabilities develop when fluids of different densities accelerate against the density gradient, or like, you know, when a flow of water is on the ceiling and falling down on the effect of gravity. The interfacial mixing of the fluids actually is timed, and this mixing is believed to be self-similar. In realistic environments, accelerations are often variable. And what our points in this talk would be that this self-similar mixing with variable acceleration possess special properties and belong to a special self-similarity class. This dynamics, self-similar dynamics, may vary from superballistics to subdiffusion, and yet, depending on the acceleration, and yet for any acceleration, this process, Raleigh-Taylor mixing, keeps memory of deterministic conditions. If I would like to summarize the content of this talk, I would say that the properties of Raleigh-Taylor and Richtmeier-Meshkov mixing depart from those of other self-similar processes, including Kolmogorov turbulence, and those that are prescribed by self-similar or would release the Yukovich-Landau. So classical Raleigh-Taylor instability develops for constant acceleration when we have a heavy fluid, when we have a heavy fluid like water on the top, atmospheric pressure, which is in principle, hence to the fifth power Pascal, should be sufficient to maintain a water column in 10 meters in height, however, or in height, however, small amount of water flows out from an overturned cup, and we see it because the interface is unstable with respect to small perturbations, they start to grow, interface becomes very corrugated, we have bubbles which are coming up, it's a light fluid, we have spikes of the heavy fluid coming down, there is a secondary instability developing on this interface, and instability is called Raleigh-Taylor in honor of Raleigh-Taylor, who were actually discovering it, like, you know, in studying it theoretically and experimentally. Classical Richtmeier-Meshkov instability develops when acceleration is driven by a shock or when it is impulsive, and I would like to emphasize the numerical works of Professor Glim, like, you know, that were done, like, you know, in capturing the important aspects of these processes. We were discussing, and actually a number of questions was raised that in the earlier sessions, especially on Monday, what is the difference between, say, diffusion and interfacial mixing? And I would like to provide these molecular dynamic simulations, maybe one of the first, at Reynolds number 10 to the 5th power 5, where we see that actually two fluids being a subject of acceleration, and acceleration is huge, 10 to the power 10 of Earth's gravity, is directed from red to blue, from heavy to light. So we see how the interface starts to evolve with time. We have small corrugations and they start to grow, and what we have here is an interfacial mixing. However, if you take a piece of fluid here at the interface, zoom it in, we will see that there is a lot of diffusion occurring at molecular scales. So we are talking about this process, not that process. So this is interfacial mixing. This is our diffusive mixing, even though they might be related. Supernova, like, you know, these instabilities are important to study because they play important role in a broad range of phenomena, like, you know, supernova and supernova remnants. And in supernova, core collapse supernova, the blast wave causes the instability to develop, mixes the layers of the progenitor stars, And the mixing is believed to provide conditions for synthesis of the heavy elements, mass elements, and intermediate mass elements, which later on observed in the galaxy through these non-uniform structures. Supernova remnants, as you may see it here, they are filled with filaments produced by the Rayleigh-Taylor and Rickmeyer-Meshkov instabilities, and different colors in these elements, actually, in these pictures, even though these are felt colors, but they do show that there is a very non-uniform abundance of chemical elements that is actually showing that the explosion process and then the instability mixing driven, like, you know, expansion, it's also a non-one-dimensional problem. So nanofabrication and material processing, it's also another application of Rayleigh-Taylor Rickmeyer-Meshkov instabilities. There was a talk earlier on MD simulations of nuclear material melting, and I just would like to reiterate, this is actually formation of a tiny jet, like, you know, when a shock wave hits a material and you see the melting and deposition of the material. And atomizations would be another application of the Rayleigh-Taylor instabilities, and in this case, the interfacial mixing may define the droplet size distribution and may also define the dynamics of the jet or a plume, and these are cross-flow atomization, I believe, even though atomization in an engineering community is used in a little bit different meaning. So it's not atoms, it's actually small droplets. So what is known and what is not so known about Rayleigh-Taylor dynamics? Usually, and Professor Glynn, please correct me if I'm wrong in something. So we have linear regime, nonlinear regime, and so similar regime in case of constant acceleration. In the linear regime, a small perturbation at the interface grows exponentially, quickly. Then the growth is not as quick, but it still continues. So rather than having an exponential growth, we have a power law. It's actually a constant velocity case. And eventually the transition occurs from this regime to this regime. When we have everything, the width of the mixing growth increases quadratically with time. And Rayleigh-Taylor flow, in this case, is characterized by large-scale structures, which actually keeps memory of the initial conditions, by small-scale structures, which appear because of shear at the interface, and by energy transfer at large and small scales. And I would like to point your attention here that there is an important parameter here. If it would be, say, just free fall, like, you know, in Galileo-Galilei's experiment, it would be some function of the density ratio multiplied by the coefficient 1/2. But to professors, according to Professor Glynn's simulations done a number of years ago, this number is not 1/2, it's a 1/2 multiplied by 0. Essentially one number of 10%, so it's a small parameter. Theoretical problem is described by the conservation of mass, momentum, and energy. We have our gravity field being present in the pressure form. We have our acceleration being a power law function of time. And we introduce this power law because on the side of applications, the power laws may lead to new scaling properties, whereas on the side of fundamentals, on the side of applications, power laws can be applied to adjust a specific time dependence of the acceleration in practice. Viscous terms may be added. For instance, if we have viscosity, then this equation momentum should be modified with this term, and also energy equation should be modified. We have freely evolving, unknown, unstable interface, boundary conditions at the interface, boundary conditions at the outside boundaries, and boundary conditions set by the initial conditions that define symmetries and scales. And if we have our fields of velocity, of density, velocity, pressure, and energy density, and we apply Heaviside function h of theta, then we actually may describe by using these expressions the entire flow field in the heavy fluid subdomain and also in the light fluid subdomain. And there is our normal and tangential vectors for the velocity. So boundary conditions at the freely evolving interface include the continuity of normal component of velocity and pressure at the interface, and discontinuity of tangential component of velocity and enthalpy at the interface. So these two quantities may jump, and jump can be arbitrary, where these two quantities are continuous. I kindly point your attention here also that this equation, continuity of normal component of velocity at the interface, doesn't contain any fluid density. It's free of it. So it means that actually the overall dynamics should be specific. That is, we need to count dynamics per unit mass rather than per unit volume. So density is not included. We have boundary conditions at the outside boundaries of the domain and boundary conditions set by the initial conditions. In a sense, if you would like to prescribe, like, you know, this problem with a certain symmetry of initial conditions, we need to know what it is. So the approach that I've been working, like, you know, for a long time was based on a group theory, and I will give, like, you know, just a brief introduction what it is, and then we will proceed to solve similar regimes very quickly. So a group in general is an algebraic structure. It's an abstract algebraic structure. It's a set of elements, and there are elements that belong to the group, and they have a binary interaction called product, such that the product is associative. There is a unit element in the group. Each element in the group has an inverse element in the group, and the product of each two elements in the group belong to the group. Why is it important? Because it actually includes everything and excludes nothing. So whatever is in is being kept in. And prominent applications of group theory, like in science, are known to everyone because it's a harmonic analysis, it's a group theory, Fourier series is a group theory, just like, you know, just from a different point of view. In our case, we use this approach to describe scale-dependent dynamics. When, for instance, if you will be looking at the XY plane here, we may implement various groups corresponding to some initial perturbations, such as a group of square or a group of hexagon. And whereas in the scale dependence and of similar dynamics, we may realize these equations in a momentum model. So in the former case, we apply like a lot of mathematical calculations and derivations technique, deriving the flow fields in the bulk, redefining the equations, and eventually deriving the dynamical systems in terms of moments and surface variables in every order approximation, and finding solution for it at every moment of time. So it's an example of a nonlinear behavior of velocity depending on the curvature of the interface morphology. And I kindly point your attention that in the nonlinear regime, there is no a unique solution. And this was first noticed by Paul Garabedian back in 1957. On the other hand, we may theorize that our dynamics is driven by specific per unit mass balance of the rate of momentum gain and rate of momentum loss. These rates are projections of vector along the gravity, and they are associated with the energy, rate of energy gain and rate of energy dissipation. So for the rate of energy gain, we have actually this is associated with the buoyant force, and for the rate of energy dissipation, we have this relation, which is the same as in Kolmogorov, except for the length scale. Here now can be a vertical length scale or a horizontal length scale. The power, this is standard relations for the power and force, and B and C here is a buoyancy and, I would say, drag parameters, but they're not just a buoyancy and drag parameters, but buoyancy and drag parameters that may be positive or negative values, and the entire system may be described, like, you know, applied to describe the bubbles and spikes. And even though, if you will be looking at this expression and comparing, for instance, with this Keeling expressions when we have nonlinear PDEs plus nonlinear boundary conditions, and we would understand that this is actually a set of ODEs, the surprising thing that the buoyancy and the drag, they can be both precisely derived from the governing equations. Specifically, we may identify the buoyancy and the drag parameters in the linear, nonlinear, and mixing regime. We know what they are, how do they behave, for instance, on the amplitude or a specific curvature, how do they depend on the output number, on the density ratio. It's important that they are different in different regimes. They are different for bubbles and spikes. However, they are the same for Rayleigh-Taylor and Richtmeier-Meshkov case. Because Rayleigh-Taylor from Richtmeier-Meshkov differs between, like, you know, the balances between these two terms. However, the buoyancy and drag parameters are insensitive to this. So it's an example of a buoyancy for the bubble and buoyancy for the spike. And this is a drag for the bubble and drag for the spike, depending in the nonlinear regime on the interface morphology or the curvature. From these relations, we may derive our solutions for the bubbles and for the spikes in Rayleigh-Taylor case, for the bubble and for the spikes in Richtmeier-Meshkov case, which would be exactly the same as we were studying before in terms of, like, you know, dynamical system approach. What is important here, that group theory also captures the flow of fields in Rayleigh-Taylor, Richtmeier-Meshkov dynamics. Specifically, it shows that dynamics is essentially interfacial because it has intense fluid motion near the interface. It has effectively no motion far away from the interface, and it has shear-driven vertical structures at the interface. And these results actually very well agrees with the numerical simulations and possibly also with experiments, even though experiments don't report these motions quite often, maybe it would be something good to report. And I would like to point attention that since the dynamics in the interfacial, then the approaches developed for the front tracking numerical simulations or a front capturing, interface capturing numerical simulations, they should play a very important role. Cell-similar mixing is often considered as a something cell-similar to cell-similar turbulence. Why is it so? Because if you will be looking in a constant acceleration case for velocity, integral scale, Reynolds number, we will see that this quantity increases very quickly with time t. So in fact, actually, Reynolds number grows cubic with time. At the same sense, at the same time, energy dissipation rate also grows linearly with time. A formal viscous scale decays with time, and the span of scales increases with time. So what we have a situation when the velocity grows, length scale grows, energy dissipation rate grows, Reynolds number grows. It's an ideal condition to presume that a canonical turbulence may develop. And this idea is actually very implemented for a long time, maybe starting from the works of Wielenki and Fradkin, with understanding that probably initially when the Reynolds number will be very high, we will have a homogenization of the flow and transition to canonical turbulence. So the provocative question is, may Rayleigh-Taylor mixing be a superturbulence? It appeared that the experiments in fluids, these were the experiments of Meshkov, as well as in plasmas, they sort of at Reynolds number that may be as high as up to 10 to the power 6 here and 3 million actually in Meshkov's experiments, they show that even at a very late time, the flow remains non-uniform and homogeneous, and it keeps the interfacial structure, which was here. And furthermore, if you would keep some memory of implement some well-defined initial conditions, we would be able to keep this memory of initial conditions at a very long time. In fact, these results resonated also with the early experiments by like Srinivasan and also Taylor, who were studying the effect of acceleration on turbulent flows, and they were showing that under the strong accelerations, turbulent flows may laminarize. And for constant acceleration, the group theory actual approach explains these experiments, but now we would like to consider the variable acceleration case. So I will be discussing, like, you know, very quickly, essentially, the situation within the framework of momentum model. So first of all, and we know that in this momentum model is directly linked to the conservation law. So even though it looks simplified, but I know what the we know what the parameters are. In this case, for variable acceleration, we see that there are two regimes. One is a Rayleigh-Taylor in the mixing regime. There is a Rayleigh-Taylor regime, and there is a Richtmeier-Meshkov regime, and it's all defined by the critical exponent of the acceleration, A critical, which is influences the flow drag. So essentially, when our drag changes from zero to infinity, our A critical changes from minus one to minus two for the exponent of the acceleration. And somehow remarkably, this is where all the blast waves, explosions, implosions belong. On the other hand, we also have the deterministic conditions, which would be actually our integration constants, which define the critical acceleration strength set solely by these deterministic conditions. So this is modeling of Rayleigh-Taylor and Richtmeier-Meshkov type of mixing when acceleration is a power law with time, when our acceleration is above critical exponent. And we see here that this is our acceleration and this is our system acceleration. We see that the acceleration in this case drives the dynamics. In Richtmeier-Meshkov situation, even acceleration is present, its effect is quantitatively negligible. So it's actually solely defined by the deterministic conditions. So for variable acceleration, our Rayleigh-Taylor mixing is driven by the acceleration and the factor defined by acceleration parameter and strength, by acceleration parameters and drag. In Richtmeier-Meshkov mixing, it's driven solely by the drag and deterministic conditions, and the prefactor for the acceleration is defined by the deterministic conditions. What is interesting, even though, that because here we transition from a situation when we have one-dimensional parameter g to a situation when we have another dimensional parameter g critical, which is set by some deterministic condition, the transition from RT to RM regime is singular in nature. It's actually because we cannot organize a smooth transition from here. So the question is, if you will be comparing Rayleigh-Taylor versus Kolmogorov turbulence, I would like just to provide these two figures, picture of in the experiments of Meshkov, as well as the figure in the experiments of homogeneous turbulent, the tropic turbulence by Srinivasan, and ask whether they look any similar. Because in one case, we have a well-defined interface. In the other case, we do have a sort of observed homogenization. So in terms of symmetry properties, we also have different symmetries, not only in terms of, like, you know, Galilean transformations, rotations, and reflections, but most importantly, in terms of scaling transformations. Because if we take our Kolmogorov theory, our governing equations, and apply the scaling transformation to these governing equations, we will find that in the limit of vanishing viscosity, which is here, our scaling exponent would be equal to one third, and the measure of the scaling exponent or invariant form of the scaling transformation is the rate of energy dissipation, is the rate of dissipation of specific kinetic energy. In Rayleigh Taylor, we have a different situation because we have all these complicated equations, including boundary conditions plus initial conditions, blah, blah. But we also have a different scaling transformation. This is because we have a different dimensional parameter, different control parameter. And in this case, the exponent of the scaling transformation will be dependent on the exponent of the acceleration, for variable acceleration. And the measure invariant form of this scaling transformation would be a quantity which we would call modified rate of change of specific momentum, which is actually has this dependence on the velocity and characteristic length scale. And this is a quantity similar to acceleration strength. And if it would be Riemann-Meshkov, it would be critical acceleration strength. So for the similar Rayleigh Kolmogorov turbulence, we have scaling exponent one third energy dissipation rate being an invariant form. For the similar Rayleigh Taylor mixing, we have scaling exponent this and the invariant form is a modified rate of momentum. For Riemann-Meshkov mixing, we have scaling exponent being a constant value, and this is our invariant form. And in both cases, we have a control parameter for each of the processes. Here is the power of external matter supplying energy to the system at a constant rate. Here is the acceleration strength. Here is the critical acceleration strength. Now let us consider scaling transformations. For Reynolds number, we have these famous expressions which defined our Reynolds number scaling as well as the energy dissipation viscous scale. For Rayleigh Taylor, we have a different situation, and what is important here, that our viscous scale remains a finite value. Even would it be a constant acceleration or a variable acceleration, it's actually a constant value. For the velocity, for the spectral properties, we will have, like, you know, kinetic energy fluctuations in Kolmogorov turbulence defined by the invariant form of the energy dissipation rate, whereas in Rayleigh Taylor mixing, we have an invariant form of the rate of momentum, modified rate of momentum, and it would be different scaling exponent here. And depending on what the acceleration exponent is, our spectrum may be steeper than Kolmogorov, the same as Kolmogorov, or more gradual than Kolmogorov spectrum. On the other hand, if you will be looking at the velocity fluctuation spectra, because it's a very different situation. In Rayleigh Taylor, we have, or Riemann-Meshkov, we have a lot of non-uniformities, non-homogeneities, we have interfaces. In Kolmogorov turbulence, we have isotropy, homogeneity, and no interfaces, roughly speaking. But what is common for them, in both cases, their dynamics is specific. That is, balances accounted per unit mass, not per unit volume, per unit mass. And as a result, all these invariant forms are free from any dependence on the density. And as a result, the density fluctuations, they should have k to the minus 1 velocity spectra in Rayleigh Taylor, Kolmogorov turbulence, as well as Riemann-Meshkov mixing. And my understanding is that these results were observed in some of the experiments. However, yes, I'm about to finalize. We have our Kolmogorov situation. Thank you so much. We have our what is, and I will be just like, you know, give a summary. If you will be looking on the main difference between, say, isotropic turbulence and Rayleigh Taylor mixing, is that it would be the following. In Kolmogorov turbulence, deterministic conditions, initial noise does not play a role. The process is fully stochastic. Whereas in Rayleigh Taylor mixing, fluctuations are set by the deterministic conditions. So this is a scaling exponent in Rayleigh Taylor and Riemann-Meshkov mixing depending on the prop of the acceleration exponent. We may see the velocity scaling, we may see the Reynolds number scaling, as well as the spectral density, how it's being modified. And we see that there is an entire class of self-similarity class, which would vary from superballistics to subdiffusion, actually, when we vary the only one parameter, which is the exponent of the acceleration. So in this regime, the motion is strongly correlated and moves very quickly and stronger than ballistics. Here we have a constant acceleration case. Here we have a quasi-Kolmogorov regime, where we will have the same scaling and spectral properties, but the fluctuations here are set by deterministic conditions rather than stochastic. Here we have a point of steady flux, and above we have larger velocities at larger scales. Below we have smaller velocities at smaller scales. Then we have a quasi diffusion, RT to RM dynamics, and then RM dynamics only. All blast waves and impacts, they belong to this interval, which actually may be explaining why it's so challenging for many years was to capture them. So I would like to give a few examples, like, you know, comparison. So this is a sensitivity to deterministic conditions. What we have is RM flows, same conditions, if we will be looking here and here, or here and here, like same output numbers, same Mach numbers, same initial perturbations. Here we have two initial modes of the pattern with two initial perturbation waves being an anti-phase configuration, which allows to keep order at late time. Here there was a random phase configuration, which led to a disordered structure. One may even say that it's a turbulent, but it's not. It's actually, it's fully stochastic because it's set by deterministic conditions. This is the experiments in fluids where we can see, like, you know, that some initial conditions, such as a cone, which is implemented here, they may grow self-similarly, and the flow would remain ordered, which is actually keeping agrees with results of our theory. Or we may have a well-defined structures, periodic structures, if the initial conditions are well resolved. And I'm about to conclude. So this is the experiments in fluids by Akula et al. And GFM, where we analyzed it with our data analysis method, showing that actually our for velocity fluctuations in constant acceleration, we have minus one. And for the density fluctuations, we do have minus two and minus one. And the spectra actually are compound functions. We may actually also provide agreement with experiments in plasmas. And these are RT experiments in plasma experiments at the SACLA facility, where the data actually can be well approximated over a broad interval. And furthermore, based on this data, we may evaluate probably for the first time the value of the kinematic viscosity in plasma. Also, these are very famous results from, I think it's a 2006 Nature Physics, where these data were interpreted, like, you know, as the application of LES in modeling Rayleigh-Taylor mixing. But in fact, actually, these spectra are well defined by the compound function. And it's remarkable that exponent here is a minus one for density and about minus two for the velocity fluctuation. So even though it's, we sort of agree that it's a different situations, like, you know, Rayleigh-Taylor and Riechmeyer-Meshkov mixing and Kolmogorov turbulence, they have different properties, we can actually obtain, derive one from another, showing that they are fully consistent. For instance, in case of constant acceleration, the rate of our invariant form is a rate of momentum loss or constant acceleration, whereas energy dissipation rate is a scale dependent. And from canonical turbulence expression, we actually may derive our Rayleigh-Taylor expression, showing that it's actually there is a full consistency. So I came to conclusions. So we apply group theory to study non-equilibrium dynamics of instabilities and interfacial mixing. We found the special similarity class. And it's important that canonical turbulence is driven essentially by energy transport, whereas in our case, we have transport of mass momentum and energy. And this RT mixing has its own invariant scaling spectral properties. They depart from those of canonical turbulence and those prescribed by blast press phase. Important that dynamics can vary very broadly, from superballistics to subdiffusion. However, for any acceleration, it will be keeping memory on deterministic conditions. And this is the biggest distinction between canonical turbulence, which is a fully stochastic process. So, and definitely, if you will be using strong acceleration, we may try to linearize the Rayleigh-Taylor flow. So thank you so much. Yeah, I managed it on time.
The talk is open for questions.
In the glass of water, when you turned it upside down, the water eventually fell down and it sat on the bottom. Yep. And so it was a one-shot process. It's not a continuous process like turbulence. And also the water's on the bottom, the air is on top, there's no mixing.
I can give you an analogy. If you stop supplying energy to canonical turbulent flow, the turbulence will stop. It will not be developing because to maintain turbulence, we need a constant energy supply. Similarly, to make Rayleigh-Taylor flow moving, we need to have a delta E in potential energy that actually later on turns into motion and plus into formation of surfaces and interfaces. So it's similarly to canonical turbulence, you can turn off the power of external matter and turbulence it dissipates unless it's driven.
Since you discussed fluctuation spectra with respect to group theory, I just wanted to remark that about the work by Martin Oberlach at Darmstadt, he takes the entire single point moment hierarchy of the Navier-Stokes equations, and he finds Lie group symmetries that are obeyed level by level by all moments, and so you don't, it kind of circumvents the closure problem and gets some non-trivial results for high moments that have been validated by DNS and quite a few other things like specific configurations. I don't know enough about this to know if it's complementary to what you're doing, overlaps, whatever. Just a remark.
I would say that it's a different sort of. It's not competing. It's a normal, like
you know, right? Orthogonal.
It's
yeah.
But I mean, I would be happy to take a look at it. On the other hand, yeah. We do have, like, you know, in canonical turbulence, in a sense, simplified set of equations. We never have boundary value problem, so it's a different little bit problem.
Can you please bring back the slide where you show spectral behavior for Richtmeier-Meshkov?
It was for L.A. Taylor, this one?
Yep.
It's for L.A. Taylor.
Okay, so I just want to say that we see something somewhat similar in Richtmeier-Meshkov, and if anything, it's cleaner than experiment than in numerics. Now, one remark regarding turbulence. In our experiments, pretty much anything of interest happens within 1 millisecond, but we still do get turbulence.
That's great. And actually, yes, I would like to point your attention here that the method that I'm referring to, it was developed quite recently, but it works both with raw data and with process data. Process data, they don't provide us information on statistics, but here we work with raw data. So essentially these are raw data that looks very noisy, but this is how they look like. They were not filtered. We actually asked experimental group to provide us with raw data. And what is marked in green here, this is the data that have been fitted. And what is marked in red, this is the data that have been fitted. Let us look at the numbers. So we have constant acceleration. We have about -2 for velocity fluctuations. And we have about -1 for density fluctuations, which we also expect in Richtmeier-Meshkov instability. Exactly. But there is also one point. Let us look at this beta. Because we have actually a compound spectra. It's a product of a power law and exponential. And this is filtered out as an experimental noise, this part of the spectra. You see, like, you know, beta here for density fluctuations and for velocity fluctuations is different threefold, which means that our velocity fluctuations act self-similarly, whereas flow is multi-phase. So we don't need to get rid out of interface to have self-similarly acting velocity fluctuations.
Except it's not multi-phase in the sense.
It's not multi-phase in the sense of particle Laden flows. It's a multi-phase that it has two fluids. So in a sense, even though the fluids were mixable here, they still know that one is red, the other is blue. So they cannot mix, like, you know, to a completely whatever sort fluid, which will be purple in color. Yeah.
I have a comment on your reference to the Cabot and Cook simulations. Yeah. Those are done without subgrid models, and they are not DNS, although they're probably claimed to be DNS. So we've had many good talks in this presentation about high-quality subgrid models. I don't think that those meet the standards of the talks that were given here.
What I would like, let me respond to this number, right? So if you will be looking at these numbers here, we just analyzed their data. These are the process data. I'm not discussing, I agree with you actually. But my point is, we had analyzed just the data. Let us see what their data tell us about it. So what we have? We have -2, -2 or about -2 for the density, for velocity fluctuations. We have about -1 for the density fluctuations. But look at these betas. They are the same. So in a sense, this is how that in these numerical simulations, actually that were modeling, like, you know, the process as a sort of effective diffusive process, they don't have a multi-phase flow. Multi-phase, not in a sense of particle Laden flow, but they don't have two fluids. This is essentially the same fluid. And this is immediately reflected in their data. And definitely in their fit, that was a -5 sort somewhere between, I don't know, about 20 to 40, we can cover this huge interval with the thousand modes, showing that actually that most of the modes here, they are in a scale-dependent behavior. They are viscous. Actually, it's a mode of fastest growth. So, and I agree with you that we do need to have interface tracking.
If there are no more comments, I will close the session. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, yes. Yeah, what I mean, yeah, Miranda code was actually just mentioned for the quantum mechanic hydrodynamics.
I stand by my statement.
Okay. Okay. So let us proceed for lunch. Yes.
So something.